welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, Mario Ritter Jr. reports on the new president of Sri Lanka. Then, Bryan Lin presents this week's science report. We close the show with the lesson of the day from teachers Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first,
Sri Lanka's new president faces many choices as he tries to balance ties between the country's two huge partners, India and China. Anura Kumara Dissanayake is the leader of a coalition headed by a Marxist political party. The same party unsuccessfully launched rebellions in the 1970s and 1980s. Marxism is a set of political beliefs linked to Karl Marx, one of the writers of the Communist Manifesto. Dissanayake is the leader of the National People's Power Alliance. His party is the People's Liberation Front, which is known as the JVP. Dissanayake entered public politics in 1993. He aimed to rebuild the JVP party after the failed rebellions of earlier years. The party gained its first seat in parliament in 1994. In 1997, he became an organizer of the Socialist Students' Union and joined the Central Committee of the JVP. 1 year later, he joined the party's Politburo. Dissanayake was first elected to parliament in 2000. At the time, the party entered an alliance with President Chandrika Kumaratunga. Dissanayake served for a short time as Agriculture and Irrigation Minister. Later, the JVP supported President Mahinda Rajapaksa to defeat the Tamil Tiger Rebel Group. The ethnic minority separatist group carried out a civil war that lasted 26 years. The Tamil Tigers were finally crushed in 2009. By 2014, the JVP elected Dissanayake as its leader. The new JVP leader realized that his party alone could never gain enough support to rule. So, in 2019, he formed an alliance of parties called the NPP. It brought together 21 groups, including political parties, youth groups, women's groups, trade unions, and other civil society groups. Since the formation of the coalition, Dissanayake has moved away from publicly supporting traditional socialist ideas such as banning private property and one-party rule. Although he is head of a Marxist party, he says he supports a free market economy. He ran for president of the NPP coalition for the first time in 2019. But he lost to Gotabaya Rajapaksa, who fled the country 2 years later because of the country's deep financial crisis. Dissanayake entered office with promises to raise the standard of living and to clean up government corruption. he promised that politicians and officials would be held responsible for their actions. He also said he would end privileges for politicians and former presidents. His supporters expect him to ease austerity measures put in place so the country could receive loans from the International Monetary Fund, IMF. Last year, Sri Lanka reached a deal with the IMF for a $3 billion loan because it could not pay its foreign debts. Dissanayake has promised to continue that deal. He also said he will support local businesses instead of depending only on foreign investors. But for the country's Tamil minority, the future is not hopeful. Dissanayake has rejected giving more power to the northern and eastern areas where most Tamils live. He has also rejected investigating incidents during the civil war that United Nations investigators have described as possible war crimes. Tens of thousands of civilians were killed in the final months before the Tamil Tiger rebels' defeat. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
A new study suggests sources of water on the moon are more widespread than previously thought. The study was based on new examinations of data collected by India's Chandrayaan-1 spacecraft. It launched in October 2008 and collected data while orbiting the moon for about a year. Chandrayaan-1 has already provided evidence of water on the moon. In September 2009, scientists published a study based on data from the Indian space mission. The data showed the presence of molecules linked to water as well as the substance hydroxyl. The American Space Agency, NASA, describes hydroxyl, or OH, as a molecule made up of one hydrogen atom and one oxygen atom with a free, unpaired electron. It notes it is one of the most reactive gases in the atmosphere and can help break down other gases in the air. The 2009 study suggested the water molecules identified by Chandrayaan-1 data were mainly found in the moon's extreme northern and southern areas, known as the poles. Scientists said the data from that study showed most of the water probably existed in large craters near the poles where sunlight is blocked. But new examinations of the data show that water and hydroxyl molecules likely exist over much wider areas of the moon. In addition, the research suggests water is even present in areas of the moon receiving direct sunlight. The instrument aboard Chandrayaan-1 that captured the molecule data is called the Moon Mineralogy Mapper, or M3. NASA built and operated the instrument. The space agency describes M3 as an imaging spectrometer.
A spectrometer is an instrument used to study the chemical composition and structures of substances. On the Chandrayaan-1 mission, the spectrometer aimed to map the mineral composition of materials on the moon's surface. Researchers examined this data and centered their search on areas outside the lunar poles. They found that the sources of water and hydroxyl are believed to be contained in minerals on or just below the moon's surface. Scientists involved in the research recently reported their results in a study published in the Planetary Science Journal. The research was led by Roger Clark, a senior scientist at the Planetary Science Institute. In a press release announcing the findings, the researchers noted their discovery was made possible by data that the M3 instrument collected. They explained the instrument provides highly detailed data using imaging and infrared technologies. The M3 instrument, for example, can identify 85 different colors in its examinations of mineral compositions. This compares to normal digital cameras, which generally only record 3 colors. The researchers said, just like we see different colors from different materials, the infrared spectrometer can see many infrared colors to better determine the composition, including the water and hydroxyl. The team noted the water might have resulted from heating of rocks and soil or from chemical reactions that combined different hydroxyls to produce water as well as oxygen. Clark from the Planetary Science Institute said both cratering and volcanic activity can bring water-rich materials to the surface. He noted that both are observed in the newly examined data. We see a lunar surface with complex geology with significant water in the subsurface and a surface layer of hydroxyl. The discovery, Clark said, can be helpful to future exploration efforts on the moon. Future astronauts may be able to find water even near the equator by exploiting these water-rich areas. He added, knowing where water is located not only helps to understand lunar geologic history, but also where astronauts may find water in the future. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn joins me to talk more about his science report. Thanks for being here, Bryan.
Sure, Ashley. Glad to be here.
This week, you reported on a new study suggesting the moon has more widespread sources of water than previously thought. I know there have been some similar studies released in recent years, but in what ways is this one different?
I would say the main difference is that researchers involved in the latest study concluded there are many areas of the moon that likely have water sources, even if much of that water is in the form of molecules inside minerals in moon rocks and soil. And they made the point that even areas receiving sunlight could contain water. Most past research has suggested the water sources are centered around the moon's pole areas, but at least one other study has provided some evidence of water in other places.
What can you tell us about that study?
So that one was released in 2020, and it also provided evidence that water molecules likely exist across wide areas, even on sunlit parts of the lunar surface. This one was based on data from another source, a specially designed aircraft operated by NASA that is equipped with a very large telescope. But both the latest and previous studies are based on newer instruments that permit scientists to collect more exact data. And it is interesting to note that up until about 15 years ago, researchers believed the moon was mostly dry. So many new technologies are now permitting them to collect even more data and make new discoveries.
All right. Thanks again for being here, Bryan, and thank you for your report.
Sure, Ashley. Thank you.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Anna feels lucky to be in Washington because many special events take place in the city. In a previous lesson of the day, we followed Anna as she visited a festival for the famous English playwright William Shakespeare. And in today's lesson, Anna goes to another festival.
This time, in lesson 24 of the Let's Learn English series, Anna goes to a folklife festival. A festival is a special program of events that usually celebrates a particular topic.
For example, a festival might celebrate traditions connected to a national holiday or the culture of a particular nationality. Or festivals might celebrate topics such as books, old cars, or a particular style of music. Festivals often take place outdoors in public places.
Folklife refers to traditional aspects of a culture, such as music, dance, clothing, and food, that have lasted for several generations.
And the word folk simply means people.
But Jill, you know what? I think we have digressed away from Anna.
Yes, I think we have. To digress means to start talking about things less closely related to the main topic. So let's come back to Anna and the Folklife Festival. The official name of the event is the Smithsonian Folklife Festival. The Smithsonian is a large group of museums, education, and research centers created by the U.S. government. Now let's listen to Anna in lesson 24.
I was at work. And I wanted a break. So I walked and walked and walked and walked. Then I saw something. It was a festival, a big festival. It's the Smithsonian Folk Life Festival. Yes, it was the Smithsonian Folk Life Festival. Every year, the festival shows different cultures. This year, one of the cultures was the Basque culture. There was dancing and food and games.
I am dancing a traditional Basque dance.
At the festival, I danced a traditional Basque dance. They are cooking traditional Basque food. They cooked a lot of traditional Basque food.
Nice shot.
They are playing a game. It's a kind of handball. What do they call it? They call it pelota. They played a game with their hands and a small ball. It's a kind of handball. But this game is called pelota.
Anna learned new things about Basque culture. Basque refers to a region and culture in the northeastern part of Spain. There, the people speak both Spanish and the Basque language.
Andrew, our listeners might be interested to know that even though the Basque language is spoken by people in Europe, the language is not related to other European languages. In fact, linguists, which means people who study languages, think the Basque language is older than the other languages in Europe. That means people have been speaking Basque for a very long time.
Let's look at how Anna asked about the handball game they were playing. She didn't know the name of the game. When we don't know the name of something, we usually use the verb call to ask about it. Listen.
What do they call it? They call it pelota.
This is a very useful expression in English. Although we sometimes say, what is the name of that place? For a particular place, such as a restaurant. For many other things, we say, what do you call it? Or, what is that called? What is this called?
So, if you are learning English and you don't know the name of an object or an activity, you can just say, what do you call this?
And the answer uses the passive form of the verb, is called. Listen.
It's a kind of handball. But this game is called pelota.
I'm Andrew Smith, and you're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. In the lesson of the day, we like to give examples of how native speakers pronounce phrases when they are speaking quickly.
What do you call it? Sounds like this when we say it quickly. What do you call it?
We change the three words, what do you, to whaddaya when we speak quickly. Whaddaya means what do you.
And our listeners should also notice that we don't really pronounce the letter T at the end of the phrase. Instead of saying call it, we say call it with a held T.
We talked about the held T in a previous lesson of the day, when we compared the pronunciation of the verb can and its negative form, can't. Now, listen to Jill and me give more examples of fast speech with the verb call. Ready? Listen. What is this called?
What is that called?
What is it called?
What do you call it?
Let's look closely at one of those sentences. Speaking slowly, I can say, what is it called? But when I speak quickly, it changes to, what is it called? What is becomes reduced to what is. The letter T in what changes to a sound closer to the letter D. And the word it goes by so fast that it becomes very reduced to just a vowel sound plus a very fast held T. It. 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 What is it? What is it? What is it? What is it called?
We sometimes use the phrase, what do you call, to make jokes. For example, what do you call a police officer in bed?
A police officer in bed? I don't know. What do you call a police officer in bed?
An undercover cop.
Huh. That's pretty good. When you're under the covers, you are lying under blankets in bed. And cop is a short word for police officer. Here's one for you, Jill. What do you call something that goes up when the rain comes down?
An umbrella?
You got it. You're pretty good at this.
Hey, thanks. There's another detail from Lesson 24 of the Let's Learn English series we should mention. When we use the simple past of regular verbs in English, we pronounce the ed ending three different ways, depending on the spelling of the verb. We can hear Anna use the three different pronunciations.
Yesterday started like a usual work day. I was at work, and I wanted a break. So I walked and walked and walked and walked. They played a game with their hands and a small ball. It's a kind of handball, but this game is called pilota.
With the first examples, the verbs started and wanted, you can hear the extra syllable id. Started, wanted. We add this extra syllable when the verb ends in the letter T or D.
With the verb walked, you can hear the sound of the letter T. Walked.
We add the T sound when the verb ends in a voiceless consonant, like the letters K and P. Worked. Stopped.
And the third way we pronounce is with the sound of the letter D. Played. Called. We add this when the verb ends with a voiced sound like a vowel or like the letter V, loved. Let's listen to Anna use the three different pronunciations one more time.
Yesterday started like a usual work day. I was at work and I wanted a break. So I walked and walked and walked and walked. They played a game with their hands and a small ball. It's a kind of handball, but this game is called pilota.
Jill, what do you call a podcast that has run out of time? Overcast.
You mean it's cloudy?
No, you know, as in the lesson is over.
Oh, it's over. Well, time flies when you're having fun. You can learn more on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. You can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. And thanks for listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.